Hi, I'm Penny Carlson, and welcome to Topics in Digital Photography, Using a Digital DSLR.
Hopefully we're going to have a lot of fun in this class, and by the end of it, you're going to become better photographers. The purpose of this class is to help you on that journey, to teach you how to take control of your camera and learn all its settings, and to teach you how to use software to get the best out of every picture that you take. Requirements for this class will be that you have a camera with some type of manual control, and that you have access to Adobe Photoshop, preferably CS6 version, but the older CS5 version will also work. Now, Adobe Photoshop's a very expensive program. You can get a great discount on it as a student, and I'll show you how to do that. You can buy it through Rutgers, or you can use Adobe Photoshop in the computer labs at Rutgers. Okay, so what type of camera is suitable for this course? A digital SLR, DSLR, is the equivalent of what a 35mm film camera used to be. It has pretty much the same controls, and most of them work the same way. Actually, this one uses a little bit newer technology. But they basically have the same components as the older 35mm film cameras had, except they take the pictures digitally, take and store the pictures digitally, which is a real advantage because you can see the pictures right away and you can delete the pictures that you don't want to keep. Now, the key for camera that you're using in this class is that it has some type of manual controls. Here's a closer look at digital SLR. And the key thing we want to look at here, or with any camera that you're thinking about using for this class, is you're going to look for a program dial. I think pretty much any camera out there that's going to have manual controls is going to have this program dial. Let's zoom in on it a little bit. So here's your program dial, and you'll see that you have various settings here. There's your manual control, and with the manual control, you'll set both the time that the exposure will take place and the aperture, or the amount of light that the camera lets in. So you'll control both of those. Here's your time value. That'll either be S on a camera or TV. And with that, you set the amount of time you want the photograph to take, and the camera will set the correct lens opening or aperture so that the photograph is properly exposed. This is the setting I tend to use the most. It's aperture priority. And with that, you set the lens opening, and then the camera sets the correct amount of time for you to take a properly exposed picture. And you can adjust those so the exposure is underexposed or overexposed. Okay, the other thing that you want to look at is your ISO setting. Okay, with the ISO setting, that actually sets the, what in the old film cameras would be the equivalent of the film speed. Basically, if you set a higher ISO, it'll let you take faster and less blurry pictures. If you set a lower ISO, you can't take your pictures as fast, but they'll have less, in the old film cameras, what they'd call film grain, or in
digital SLRs and other types of digital cameras what we call noise. Okay, so those are the most important components in learning how to take control of your camera. Your film speed, your aperture, and your time.
So if you want the actual best quick picture quality and you want to be able to blow up poster size pictures to hang on your wall, you want to invest in a DSLR, digital single lens reflex. The DSLR is very much like the old 35 millimeter film camera. It's basically the same build, but it takes pictures digitally. Okay, the advantage of a DSLR over other types of cameras is image quality. It has a much larger surface that records the actual light that the light hits or the camera sensor. So that means you get better picture quality. And in particular, if you take pictures in low light, you end up with a lot less digital noise. Another advantage of a DSLR is that you can change lenses. I have an all-purpose lens on it now. This is a macro lens. So a macro lens lets you take close-ups. I use this for butterflies, flowers. Some people use it for taking pictures of items that they want to sell on eBay. Get my camera cap back on. It's always good to keep all your caps in place, keep your equipment nice and clean. This lens is a zoom lens. It brings small subjects like birds that are fairly far away in close so you can get some detail. This is a great lens if you want to take pictures of birds and wildlife. It's also a fairly expensive lens. And that's the disadvantage of the DSLRs, is that the DSLR itself is quite expensive. And then when you start adding all of these accessories, lenses, you can add flash units, you end up spending sometimes thousands of dollars. Okay, but you can get a basic DSLR set up with a kit lens, probably for $500 or a little bit less. Okay, the next step down from a DSLR, also an excellent camera I don't have an example of. It would be a mirrorless interchangeable lens camera. Mirrorless interchangeable lens camera. A DSLR actually has a mirror that snaps up when you take the picture. That reflects the image into the viewfinder. So the image that you're looking at through the lens is exactly what the lens sees. The mirrorless interchangeable lens cameras take comparable quality pictures to the DSLRs. They generally have a little bit smaller sensor, although some of them have full-size sensors. And sometimes a little bit less expensive than DSLRs, but not very much so. Often they're a little bit smaller, they're smaller systems, so that would be the advantage. Okay, your next step down in a camera would be a bridge camera. And we'll define a bridge camera as a digital camera that has the ability to take control of your settings. So it has manual settings. And usually, as we mentioned, it'll have this dial. So look for the M. Usually if the camera has manual settings, it'll also allow you to use shutter priority and aperture priority. Bridge cameras vary a lot in quality and size. Some of them are a lot smaller than this one. This is a fairly old bridge camera. You could probably pick up one like this quite inexpensively used on eBay, and it'd work fine for this class. You can see it kind of looks like a mini DSLR. But some of the newer bridge cameras are a lot more compact. Our next step down is point-and-shoot. Now, bridge cameras actually fall in the point-and-shoot category, but they'll have the manual controls. For the purpose of our class, we'll look at point-and-shoots as cameras that don't have manual control. Okay, so they're a lot less flexible as far as being able to take pictures. They usually have less inexpensive quality lenses, usually very small sensor, so you get a lot of digital noise if you take night pictures. But as you can see, this camera is nice and small. This particular camera is also waterproof, so I can take it to the beach. I use it skiing sometimes. It'll actually go underwater. And it does have some control. It has scene settings. So you can put in sunset mode and it'll adjust the camera according to what it thinks will be your best settings for a sunset picture. So very limited control, but you can kind of fiddle around with it a little bit and try to get it to do what you want it to do. Okay, going one more step down, we have the camera phone, and I don't have an expensive phone, but it still takes pictures. Camera phones have gotten better. iPhones and Samsung take some pretty decent pictures, but they don't have manual settings. So although you may be able to turn in some pictures for this class that you've taken with a camera phone, you will need to be able to at least borrow somebody, maybe a friend or relative's camera that has manual settings in order to complete some of the assignments that are going to make you use the manual controls. Okay, camera phones, the main advantage is that you pretty much always have it with you. So you may get some shots that you wouldn't have otherwise been able to get. I like to actually carry a camera with me at all times, but still, the camera phone's small, it's pocketable, and a lot of shots are being taken. In fact, more shots are being taken today with camera phones than with any other type of system. This is an online class, and you'll be able to complete all the assignments without ever coming to Rutgers as long as you have access to Adobe Photoshop, which is also available in the Rutgers computer labs. Okay, even though you'll be able to complete all your assignments without ever coming to Rutgers, I'm also going to be around. I'm a Rutgers employee. I'm here every day. And I'm going to be around to give you some help whenever you need it. So if you're feeling a little bit nervous about how to use all the settings on your camera, or maybe you need a little bit of extra help using the tools in Photoshop, I'll be there to personally help you out. I envision setting up some Photoshop sessions. May be a beautiful day in the fall that I send out an email and say, hey, anybody that wants to come over and shoot some sunset pictures, meet me over at Hellier Woods at 5 o'clock. Even though this is an online class, it's not a self-paced online class because I expect us all to be doing the same thing and interacting. I expect assignments to be done on time. There will be time limitations when you have to take the quizzes by specific dates. And that will be part of your grade, getting your assignments done in a timely manner. Main components of grading, the most important component will actually be your photographic assignments. The second most important component will be that you're participating, interacting with other students. And the least important component will actually be the quizzes. I'll probably pay more attention to the idea that you actually did the quizzes on time than I will to your grades on the quizzes. I think you're going to find that when we use Flickr and social media, that you're going to get to know students in this class better than you'd actually get to know them in a lecture format class. We're going to be interacting a lot. You're going to be critiquing each other's photographs, commenting on each other's photographs. So I hope that you're actually going to interact with other students in the class more than you would in a normal class.
There are lots of great websites set up for showcasing your photography. So instead of using eCollege for that purpose, we're going to use one of the more popular ones, Flickr.com. And it'll be a much better way to showcase your photography so that everyone in the class and those outside of the class, if you want to set it up that way, can look at things. And You'll be able to also interact and post comments about each other's photography using Flickr. So I already have a Flickr account, but I kind of use Flickr to showcase my best work, and I may want to post some photographs for this course that show you what not to do. So I think I'll come up with a new account for my bad photography. So we're going to create a new account. And if you have a Flickr account, you can certainly use that. Or if you want to create an account just for this class, you can create a new account. Flickr, the basic usage is free, so it doesn't cost you anything to set up a Flickr account that you can use for this class. So let me put my name in. Okay, I'm going to try to choose a Yahoo ID that hasn't been used. That can be difficult sometimes. Okay, and you'll see that they want you to use a password that's got a capital letter and some type of special character. So let's see. All right, I've got my password set up. Now it's going to ask you for your birth date, gender, language, and country that you reside in. Actually, you'll see that people post from all over the world in Flickr. I'm going to pause this while I put in my birth date. That's not something that you guys need to know. Now I've set up all my private information and I have a new Flickr account. You'll see this welcome screen and it'll let you start exploring. You can go on and fool with Flickr a little bit. It's fun to do. I'll show you some of the images that have been captured during the day. And you may want to go through it and look at some of these photos. There's some really outstanding photos on Flickr. I'm going to log into my regular Flickr account so I can show you what you can do with Flickr and we can look at some of the things that I want you to do when you set up your Flickr account. Once you have a Flickr account, this is what you'll see when you first sign in. And it'll show you, if you have contacts, it'll show you some pictures that your contacts have posted. If you want to get to your Flickr page, you simply click on the U. Here are my Flickr photographs. I've been into photographing birds lately, so see I've got quite a few birds posted in here. But Flickr also lets you organize. These are my most recent photographs that I've put on Flickr. Flickr also lets you organize things into sets. So here are some of my favorite shots. A couple of things you can do with Flickr. I like to take off my navigation and menu bar if it's up when I look at Flickr so I can see the full screen. If you click on the picture again, it gives you a larger shot. And you can kind of go through and look at your photographs. Now you can see these are some of my landscape photographs. This is the Ken Lockwood Gorge. I like this photograph quite a bit. You'll learn how to do photographs like these. I use a very special process for my landscape photographs called high dynamic range photography. That's one of the things we'll talk about later in the class when we get to more advanced photo editing. And we'll show you how to do a high dynamic range photograph, which basically combines three photographs of the same scene, one underexposed, one overexposed, and one that's the correct exposure. And it gives you a lot more depth of color, more detail in your shadows and highlights, and these wonderful reflections like we see in this particular photograph. Okay, if you click on a photograph another time, it'll actually run a slideshow for you. If you click, and you can take the slideshow off. So this is nice. You can even stream this to your TV and take it down again. And the other thing Flickr lets you do is it lets people comment on your photographs. This will be something that we're going to utilize in Flickr. I'm going to want to see that you guys are communicating with each other and commenting on each other's photographs. Okay, now one of the first assignments I had was for you to post some pictures on Flickr. And the other thing I wanted you to do was to tell us a little bit about yourself. You can set up a profile on Flickr. Let's actually go back to the beginning page to look at this. And if we go to, you can see these three little dots here. There's a profile. And this is where you can tell us a little bit about yourself. I'm going to leave my profile the way it is. I mean, this is pretty much what I want you to tell me, why you're interested in photography, and then just a little bit about yourself. It doesn't have to be that long. Now that you've signed up for Flickr, you need to get your pictures on there. So, how are we going to do that? Flickr has quite a few ways that you can upload pictures. They have some apps so you can upload them for your phone. The easiest way to upload your pictures, the most straightforward, is simply to do it through the Flickr website. So right now you can see I'm on my photo stream for the new account that I set up. There are no pictures on it, so I need to upload them. If you're on your photo stream, you can see there's an upload button here. Or if you're on the Flickr main page that you get to when you sign in, it'll look like this. And you can also see that there's an upload button. You just hit the upload button, and it's easy. Go on, choose photos and videos, and it'll take you right to your files. Okay, you need to know where you've got your photos stored. It usually takes you right to the pictures menu. And let's find some photographs to upload. I'm going to look at some of the ones in my other Flickr files. Let's see, you guys need to meet my cats, so we'll upload some of my cat photos. So this one looks good. I'll hit Control and upload a few selected ones. This one's cute. And I need one of my female cat. Put this one in. Okay, there's a whole bunch there, so you just hit open. And I also told you to upload a picture of yourself, so let me find a picture. I don't really have pictures of myself on Flickr, but I've got a group shot, so let me find that. Here we go. Okay, so I've got a whole bunch of photos, and again, if you want to put more on, you just go up to that add button. If you want to take a particular photo off, you just click on a particular photo and you hit the remove button. So it's very easy. You can also add titles here. You can add your descriptions, and you just have to double click on these and you can change them. I actually do this after I've uploaded my photos, but if you want to do it before, you can. You can put in tags, which most of you probably know how to do, but we'll talk about that during one of our lectures. Okay, we're all ready. You just go to this corner button up here. We press it, upload to the photo stream, and there we go. Okay, this will take a while, so it's a good time to pause our video. Okay, now that you've opened your Flickr account, and you've got your pictures in it. This is my Prof. Penny Carlson account, so my new account. We're going to all need to connect.
So probably the easiest way for us to do that is for me to send you an email with my URL to my Flickr account. Once you get that email, you can copy it and then paste it into the navigator bar when you're in your Flickr account. Okay, and hit return. It'll take you to my Flickr photo stream. Once you're in my photo stream, just hit any picture that you want to hit. Okay, go down to where the comments are, and over on the right hand side, you'll see this little add button. So when that pops up, hit add me as a contact. Then I will get an email and I will add you as a contact. Once I've added you as a contact, I'll be able to identify you. And I'm going to send you an email to join the two groups. So you go up to get your emails in Flickr, you go up to the buddy icon. You click on that. You can actually change that buddy icon later, which I'll show you how to do. Let's see, I'm also going to change my screen size. I like a nice full screen in Flickr. One way you can do that is to hit the F11 key on your keyboard, at least if you've got a PC. Brings it up to a nice full screen. And I'm going to hit that buddy icon, and I'm going to go into my Flickr mail. I will send you an invite to join both the assignment group, which you can see that here, and the general group. You'll check your Flickr mail. You'll click on the invite that I've sent you and just accept. So now you are in the assignment group.
Join the assignments group. Now let's get our photos into the group. So what you need to do with that, normally you'll start out from your photo stream. From your photo stream, you go up to communities, click on communities, and all the groups that you belong to will come up. Since this is my new account, the only group I belong to right now is the Rutgers Assignment Group. Click on that group. Then just click this Add Photos button. Simply move some photos from your Flickr page over to the group page. Then click Add to the group. And you can see that the photos that I just added are now in the group. Alright, well, another thing I wanted to show you on this, I said I usually edited my photo titles and information after I upload them. So let me just show you how to do that. And you can do that from anywhere your photo is. I can do it once I put it in the group. So if I want to edit this, I just click on the title. And this is Apollo stalking Zeus. Click return. Okay, I can put a little description down here if I want. I'm not going to put anything, but I'm going to take out the Sony information and then just click save. Our first assignment was to open your Flickr account. That's done. Upload pictures to your Flickr account. That's done. Post some pictures to the assignment group. And if you want to post some more pictures to the general group, you can do that. And to tell us a little bit about yourself. So I mentioned this before, but I want you to tell us a little bit about yourself in your profile.
to get to your profile, I don't think it'll actually go here from the picture page. No, it does not. You have to be on your photo stream. Okay, and then you go to this little three-dot icon up here, down to your profile. To add your profile, you just simply click on Edit Your Profile. Okay, Eastern Standard Time. Female, and we'll put topic prof for topics in 35mm photography. That's enough for now. And you can put some more information in here if you want. Make sure I can identify you. So it's good to have your name on your website, your full name rather than a made up name, because I'm going to need to be able to identify you and grade you. And we'll click save it. The other thing you might want to do is to edit your buddy icon, and you can do that from here. If you want to use one of your Flickr photos, you just click on that. And let's see, let's put this one up. This corner right here is the actual icon, so you want to move it on your and resize it so you've got your buddy icon. Okay, and then click make the icon. Okay, so brand new buddy icon. We've accomplished what we want to accomplish for our first lecture. If you are thinking about buying a camera, I'd be happy to help you. And if you have any questions, feel free to email me or stop by my office. I take pictures. Photographic pictures. Bright lights. Bright lights.